Welcome. Good evening. I knew we'd have standing room only, but I haven't seen people sitting in the windows here before. My name is Bart Cameron. I'm the director here at the Prince of Wales Northern Heritage Centre. I am so pleased to see all of you here tonight. This is an official opening of Thunder in Our Voices exhibit, the 40th anniversary commemoration of the Mackenzie Valley Pipeline Inquiry. I also wanted to say, aside from that exhibit, we have opened the doors to all of our galleries, and so I hope that people can stay after the presentation and experience some of the beautiful exhibits that we have on display, as well as Thunder in Our Voices. At this point, I would like to invite the Yellowknife Dene First Nation, the Yellowknife Dene drummers, to open the exhibit, opening with a prayer song. Would people please stand?
Yeah.
would now like to invite Chief Edward Sangries onto the stage. Back to the stage. For his welcoming remarks on behalf of the Yellowknife First Nation, on whose traditional territory we all find ourselves here tonight. Chief?
Good evening. Wow. What can the thunder in our voices do after 40 years? Incredible. I'd like to thank each and every one of you for being here tonight on their traditional territory, which we call Chief Dragon's territory. We welcome a special guest tonight. He's a friend to a lot of us, and maybe a foe to a few. But no, without his help and his work and the people up the north, no, we wouldn't be where we are today, I don't think. Because as Dene, we value how we have life. We value our tradition and our culture. No, I found out that as leaders, sometimes we have to walk the fine line between economic development and the environment stewardship of our land. And we have to thank a special guest tonight for helping us along. We also give thanks to all the people in the territories who have voice, who have voices in those thunders today. Now some of them have gone on, well, some of them are still alive today. But I'd like to thank Justice Thomas Berger for doing the work that he did so that we can organize ourselves. And one of the things that he said was that there'll be no pipeline before all the land claims are settled. And he's still keeping true to his word, because there's only two regions that haven't settled yet. So hopefully those two can be settled, and then we'll talk about economic development in the north. Masicho.
Masi, Chief. I'm told that tonight, March 3rd, represents the very night, 40 years ago to this day, that Thomas Berger, formerly Justice Thomas Berger, began hearing testimony as part of the now famous inquiry. I am very honored, and on behalf of the museum, we are all honored to have Mr. Berger with us tonight for this exhibit opening on this auspicious date. I'm told it's been a very busy day for you, Mr. Berger. I hear that you spoke to a group of grade 10 Northern Studies students that was very engaging for a number of hours and have done a number of media interviews. And I think that's testament to the enduring legacy of the Mackenzie Valley Pipeline Inquiry and its importance to culture and history of the Northwest Territories. Unfortunately, the curator of this exhibit, Thunder in Our Voices, couldn't make it here tonight. Drew Ann Wake emailed me and sent me some remarks, and I would like to read a couple of things that she left with me to share with you all. I know that she would be thrilled to see so many people here tonight. So in her absence, she would like me to say, I would like to acknowledge the support of the Canada Council and the BC Arts Council. Also to Air North, who sponsored part of shipping this exhibition. Secondly, I am deeply grateful to the Decho Divisional Education Council in Fort Simpson for partnering with us every step of the way. They provided the wonderful teepee at the center of the Thunder in Our Voices exhibition. Thank you finally to Andy Norwegian and the community of Jean Marie River, who harvested the diamond willow branches and built the beautiful beaver stretchers that framed the archival photos in the exhibit. Mussy. So I am not going to speak tonight. My speech is finished. I am very, very honored, like I said, to welcome tonight's guest presenter to you all, Mr. Thomas Berger.
Thank you to Chief and Council of the folks at DEVA and to the museum. I don't think I've ever really been to this museum before. I spent my day here, and I must say it's a marvelous place. And I think it's just a great place. And when the people from the museum picked me up at the airport yesterday and said we were going to meet the high school students here today and then we were going to have a public meeting tonight, I said, well, you know, when I finished the report 40 years ago, the NWT government sent a sculptor to my house in Vancouver, and he sculpted a bust of me, and I said, I've never seen it, but it must be in the museum. And they said, well, we've never heard of it. And I said, well, go and look in the basement on some shelf at the back, and or maybe it's being used as a doorstop somewhere. Well, this museum, they know what they're doing, because I walked in here tonight, and I don't know whether you noticed, but there's a bust of me just as you come in the door, and there it is. Well, the director said that I was formerly Justice Berger, and that's quite right. I actually retired as a judge about 30 years ago, but I should tell you that during the time I was a judge, my wife, Beverly, worked as a counselor to Aboriginal students who were taking teacher training at UBC and the University of British Columbia. And because we had a big house close to the university, the students, who were mainly women, would come and use our house as a kind of home away from home. And one day I was working upstairs on a judgment, and I heard a lot of laughter and giggling below. And later on, when I came downstairs, I said to Bev, well, what was that about? And she said, well, the students are upset that the federal government has suddenly reduced the financial support provided to university students all over the country. So they want to occupy the offices of the Indian Affairs Department in downtown Vancouver, and they're going to be staying overnight and making breakfast. So I loaned them our frying pan. Well, I got to the courthouse the next day, and I got a call from the Chief Justice, who said, the Department of Justice is coming over here. They want an injunction against some First Nations women who are occupying their offices. And he said, Tom, would you hear it? Are you free? And I said, well, Chief, I think I've got a conflict of interest. I said, as we speak, they're holding our frying pan hostage. So, well, let me just say, I take it this is working. It seems to be a crack open. If nobody else notices it, who cares? I'm really glad to be here. And 40 years later, and the director is right, it is 40 years to the day since the hearings of the Mackenzie Valley Pipeline Inquiry opened at the Explorer Hotel. There's a big room there, I've forgotten what it's called, but you've all been there, I'm sure. And though it opened on March 3rd, 1975, I should tell you that I was actually appointed by the federal government to conduct the inquiry about a year before. And I came up here quietly the year before to see what people thought about the inquiry and how it should be conducted. And it became apparent to me that we had to give the Dene and the Inuit and the Aboriginal and the environmental groups and the mental health people and the municipalities a year to get ready, because I had been given a stack of expert reports that high developed by the oil and gas industry and the pipeline companies, and they were good reports. But I thought, this isn't going to be much of an inquiry if I'm just sitting there listening to people explain to me what's in this pile of material. So I did my best to give the Dene and the Inuvialuit a year to get ready. And I went to Jean Chrétien, who was then the Minister of Indian Affairs and Northern Development, and said, I can't do this properly unless you provide funding for these folks so that we can have an equal playing field, so that I'm not just there to write down what the industry tells me. And they had some excellent people who testified on their behalf, but there was another side to the story. And Mr. Chrétien went to Treasury Board and obtained the funding. So when we opened the inquiry 40 years ago today, the lawyers were there, and experts were there on behalf of the oil and gas industry and the pipeline companies. But they were also lawyers and experts there on behalf of the Dene and the Inuvialuit and the environmental groups. And so we got underway. And at the Explorer Hotel, we listened to all the experts, and all together over a period of 2 years, I heard from 300 experts who were testified on behalf of all the parties, and they were good. I mean, they were biologists, geologists, engineers, sociologists, anthropologists, and the problems that we had to deal with went from the question of frost heave when you're building a pipeline buried in the permafrost to the economics of the oil and gas industry to the future of the Dene and the Inuvialuit and the preservation of the white whales of the Beaufort Sea, the porcupine caribou bird, the fishery. It was a big job. In fact, the formal task that I was given was to consider the social, economic, and environmental impact of constructing a gas pipeline from Prudhoe Bay in Alaska, which is a gas field as well as an oil field, across the northern Yukon picking up Canadian gas from the Delta and then 900 miles south along the valley to Alberta. And at the time, I was to consider whether there should be, in fact, an energy corridor with the gas pipeline to be followed by an oil pipeline. So this was what in those days was called a mega project. And no stone was left unturned to bring these expert evidence before me across the street at the hotel, and I lived at the Explorer for a couple of years. And the experts covered every discipline known to humankind, and I thought they went a little over the top when finally they called an aesthetist. Now you may think that's somebody who puts you to sleep when you go on the operating table, but it's really an expert in aesthetics, in the way things look, in the fitness of things. And he testified that if we built a pipeline and energy corridor along the Mackenzie Valley, it would, from the aesthetic point of view, be an improvement because it would cut through the boreal forest, and travelers by air wouldn't be greeted by an unbroken cover, but would see this change in the landscape that would present a very nice alternative. Well, so, all of the experts were really very helpful because I had to learn. I'd been given this job, and I had to learn as much as I could from everybody. Well, then we held community hearings because the Dene and the Inuvialuit and their leaders had said to me, you've got to come and listen to us in the villages and the towns in the Mackenzie Valley and the Western Arctic. So I set out to listen to these folks, and I went to all 35 communities in the Mackenzie Valley and the Western Arctic, and I stayed in each one as long as people wanted me to stay. I said, look, if there's somebody here who wants to speak about this, go ahead, and I'll be here. In the summertime, those hearings went on into the midnight and afterward, and I remember in some of the villages, we had the media traveling with me, and I had some staff members, and we would have an informal pickup softball game against the local people. And I remember we had one of those late night games in Fort McPherson, because it was still light out after midnight. And a columnist for one of the national papers, Alan Fotheringham, was accompanying us. And during the ball game, I hit a home run. And he said in his column the next day that he's certain the chief had told the pitcher to serve up an easy one for the job. Well, those were great days, and it was a marvelous experience. I not only held the hearings in all of these places, and about 1,000 people spoke at those hearings, mainly Aboriginal, but many non-Aboriginal folks too. And that meant that I was traveling throughout the Mackenzie Valley and the Western Arctic. I visited hunting camps and fishing camps. I visited the man-made offshore islands where drilling was taking place in the Beaufort Sea. I saw the porcupine caribou herd, the massing of caribou in the fall when they leave the coast and head into the mountains. And it was an experience that perhaps no other Canadian had ever had ever enjoyed. And I still think of it often, and let me say how gratified I am that you are all here tonight, that you remember. Well, not all of you do, because you're not old enough to remember. Many of you remember those days and how the work that we were doing caught the attention of Northerners and Canadians generally. You know that Aboriginal people in all the communities, by a very great majority, said, "We don't want you to build this pipeline until we've settled our land claims. And we want to make sure that our right to resources for hunting, fishing, and trapping are protected in perpetuity. That we want to make sure that we play a part in the economy and the political life of the Northwest Territories, that we're not just spectators watching the world go by and playing no part in it." And so that message came through loud and clear. And then the exhibit, the films that Pat Scott, who's here, and he traveled with me and filmed everything. This inquiry was remarkable in that it occurred kind of on the cusp when we were moving into this era of films and TV and you know, God knows what else, but it meant that we had the transcripts in writing, we had a lot of radio tapes, and we had the films that Pat had made, and those are invaluable to the exhibit. And you can hear, and I played for the children, the high school kids this morning, some excerpts from the testimony given by the Dene and the Inuvialuit in some of these communities, so they could see the force and the emphasis with which people, their fathers and mothers and their grandfathers and grandmothers, and in some cases their great-grandfathers, had spoken at that time. Because some of the elders who spoke to me in the 1970s had been born at the turn of the last century. So we encompass, perhaps, tonight, looking back on it, maybe 115 years of Dene history when we think about it. I should add that I would like to take a little bit of credit for the fact that we had the beginnings of Aboriginal broadcasting in the North at that time, because when I came up here informally in 1974, a year before we started, I realized we had people speaking English, we had five Dene languages, we had Inuktitut, the language of the folks in the Western Arctic, and that this inquiry would have to be taken to all of these communities, all 35 of them. And I thought, I've got an idea. And I wrote to the president of the CBC. And I said, I've been appointed to do this inquiry. It involves all these languages. It really involves the future of the North, questions of energy, environment, Aboriginal rights. And I think you should cover it. And I think you should broadcast in English and in all the Dene languages and in Inuktitut. Well, I wrote this letter. I was telling some of the people at lunch today, the way you write letters to the government, you think, okay, I've written it, I know nothing will ever happen, but I did the best I could. Well, for heaven's sake, they went ahead and did it. And they established an Aboriginal broadcasting team, and a man named Whit Fraser led it. He was an experienced broadcaster. And every evening from 6 to 7 on the radio, they would broadcast from the inquiry what people had said, the evidence given, the arguments made. They broadcast for 10 minutes in English, and then 10 minutes in the Dene, each of the Dene languages, and then 10 minutes in Lakota. And then, as I recall, once a week, they gave them 5 minutes on national television. And they took turns, as I recall. The English language broadcaster one night, the Dene the next week, and so on. Well, I like to think that really was the beginning of Aboriginal broadcasting in the North. And I think we should, I certainly am grateful to the CBC for demonstrating what a national broadcaster can do and ought to do. Anyway, let me say that when I sat down to write my report, I had a very capable staff. I had the transcripts, and for lawyers and judges, the transcripts, you know, what everybody said, written out. I had those to refer to, and I spoke to the minister at the time, whose name was Warren Allman. This is after the hearings were completed. I'd gone to Ottawa and I said to the minister, it will take me about 6 months to complete my report. And he said, can't you do it any quicker than that? He was a good guy. And I said, no, you know, this is a big job. Everybody has taken a great interest in it. 1,000 people have testified, 300 experts. There's interest from all over the country. I'm going to do this right. And he said, well, Tom, the trouble is that your report has to be submitted to the House of Commons in both English and French. So it'll take another 6 months to translate it into French. And I said, well, why don't you appoint the French editor and the French translation team right now, and they can work with me. And the minister said, that's a really good idea, we'll do it. And we worked in a little building in Ottawa, and the French editor had the office next to mine, and of course he had to, and his team, had to translate this whole thing into French. And we got along very well, and he sometimes, quite often, every couple of days would come into my office, and he'd point to something in the draft report I had written and said, I don't understand this. And I read it. I said, I don't understand it either. So I said, I think I'd better rewrite it. So, and I did, and I should tell you, because many of you were at those hearings, I said at every hearing, I will send a copy of my report to everybody who testifies. And, you know, that was 1,000 people just for openers. And when I sat down to write it, and I told the students this morning, look, when you're my age, you know, I was over 40 when I undertook this task 40 years ago, you do the arithmetic, but I have the privilege of an elder of telling these kids this morning, giving them some good advice. I thought it was good advice. And I said, you know, they asked me, well, you went to all these hearings, how did you ever sort it out at the end? And I said, every night after a hearing, didn't matter whether I was staying in the nursing station at Fort Good Hope. Well, the nurses were kicked out, I should add. They just made it. Or whether we were out of doors somewhere, or whether it was here in Yellowknife. Every night, I wrote out on one side of one sheet of paper, what did I learn today? So when I finished, I had the makings of a report. So when I had 6 months to put it all together, I wasn't just starting from scratch. Anyway, I realized, since I was going to send it to everybody, that I should write it so that any intelligent person could read it, that it wasn't written in obscure language, some arcane lingo of the experts, which is an easy habit to fall into. And it makes it harder to do, let me tell you. Anyway, the second thing we decided was that the report should be illustrated with pictures and maps and so on, and it was. And when it finally was made public, it was on the Maclean's bestseller list for 2 or 3 months. People were going to bookstores and buying it, and it's still the best-selling book, if you will, that's ever been published by the government. Well, all right. You may. Let me also tell you that, because we're here reminiscing 40 years later, that it was read in other parts of the world. In the 1980s, I went to Alaska for 2 years to chair the Alaska Native Review Commission. And they wanted me to come because Alaska Natives and their advisors had read my report, Northern Frontier, Northern Homeland. And in the 1990s, I was asked by the World Bank to be vice chairman of a commission in India reviewing a gigantic dam project on the Narmada River that was at the time the largest water project in the world. It's since been supplanted by China's Three Gorges project. The chairman was an American, a former Undersecretary General of the United Nations, Bradford Morse. I was the vice chairman, but Mr. Morse became ill during much of the time we were holding hearings in India, so I held the hearings on my own. And I'm telling you, I could be in an Indian village on the Narmada River in the early 1990s, and somebody had a copy of Northern Frontier, Northern Homeland. Now, it's not that unusual, because in India there must be 250 million people who speak English, you know, and so that it wasn't really all that surprising, but I thought, wow. Well, let me just tell you that when I finally completed the report, I made, well, the main recommendations were, the main recommendation was not to proceed with any major pipeline project in the Mackenzie Valley until land claims were settled. And the same applied to the Western Arctic. But I told you, I think, that I mean, I know you've been considering Mackenzie Gas Project for the last 10 years or so. That's a project to bring gas from the Delta to Alberta along the Mackenzie Valley. The project I was dealing with 40 years ago was bigger than that. It was to bring the gas from Alaska, Prudhoe Bay in Alaska, which is the largest gas field in North America, as well as the largest oil field, across the north coast of Alaska, across the northern Yukon, and then to pick up the Canadian gas and bring it south. In the northern Yukon, I recommended that there be a wilderness park established to protect the calving grounds of the porcupine caribou herd, and the staging grounds of 500,000 snow geese, and that there should never be a pipeline corridor across the northern Yukon. And I had lunch with the Prime Minister of Canada at that time while I was still working on my report. Pierre Trudeau was the Prime Minister of Canada, and many of you will remember that he dominated Canadian political life for about 16 years. He died a few years ago. He had appointed me to conduct this Mackenzie Valley Pipeline Inquiry. So we had lunch when I was nearing the end of my travels. And he had come down the Mackenzie River as a young law professor in the 1950s. And he was, as you know, an outdoorsman. So he was interested. And I told him about my travels, the caribou and seeing the white whales of the Beaufort Sea and the offshore drilling rigs. And all the villages where people had spoken to me. And he said to me, you've got a good job. And I said, it's the best job in the country, Prime Minister. But before I left him, I said, sir, I am, conducting an inquiry. I'm hearing the evidence. I'm going to make recommendations, but you and your colleagues have to decide. And I said, I'll give you an example of what I mean. I said, the pipeline from Alaska, that branch of it, will cross the Arctic coast of Alaska and then the northern Yukon, and it will occupy the calving grounds of the porcupine caribou herd, which extend for about 100 miles within the Yukon, about 100 miles into Alaska. And I said, the evidence is that if that occurs, the herd over a fairly short period of time will not reproduce, and it will be reduced to a remnant from 125,000 animals. Those numbers, of course, vary. But I think that's a pretty good estimate. And I said, I will make a recommendation, but you, sir, will have to decide. And I said, can I make a suggestion? I said, it's a good idea. I can't remember exactly how I put it, but for decision makers in Ottawa to get out and see the country and see the places where these things are going to happen. And I said, if you go to the Arctic coast of the Yukon about June 1st, that's when the caribou herd arrives from the Ogilvie Mountains in the Yukon, and they come down to drop their calves on the coast over this vast calving area. And they come there because there are green shoots about June 1st coming through at the coast. And the wolves, which are harassing them, are denning further inland. And I said, this is what's at stake here. So I should tell you that I've handed in my report, and we heard no word from the government for a certain length of time. And then at breakfast one day in Vancouver, where I had returned, and the sculptor, Mr. Pfeiffer, I think his name is, was coming to sculpt me, and I sat in my den looking very wise, and you can see the results out there. But, anyway, my wife said to me one morning, my report had been made public and everybody was talking about it. She said, it says in the paper that Prime Minister Trudeau and his three sons are camping in the northern Yukon on the coast. And I said, well, I'm glad to hear it. That's what I suggested. He ought to do. And I couldn't resist saying to her, it's pretty hard to go to the northern Yukon to see the caribou herd and the calves, and then to say, right, let's put a pipeline corridor through here, the whole thing, construction, helicopters, oil and gas. And I said, you know, this is the kind of thing that decision makers should do. And that he did. Anyway, I should tell you that, as you know, the decision of the federal government was that the pipeline would not proceed. They agreed to settle land claims here in the valley and in the Yukon, and all of that work has gone on now for 40 years, and it's important work. And I think the results have given the Aboriginal people in the NWT, they've made them important players in the life, political and economic life of the NWT, and they have meant that they, under the land claims, they've secured the future of the resources they depend on for hunting, fishing, and trapping. They have, in some instances, become partners in economic development. It's I think, as the chief said earlier, made a real difference here. And could I just tell you one other thing I did? Someday I'll, if I get the time, I'll write my memoirs and include some of this stuff. But I was invited because I had said in my report, not only should Canada set aside a wilderness park in the northern Yukon to protect the calving grounds of the herd, but the United States should do the same thing on their side of the international border. And for a Canadian to be telling the U.S. what to do was so remarkable that they invited me to Washington to testify before committees of the House of Representatives and the Senate. And I did, and they listened respectfully, and I should add that the U.S., the administration of President Carter, that's how far back we go, had already begun steps to set aside as wilderness the contiguous area of the northern Alaska that we're talking about. But it has been a source of controversy in the United States now for 40 years, and to give you an example, President Clinton wanted to preserve the wilderness. Vice President Cheney, who followed, he wanted to open it up to oil and gas exploration and development. And the future of the herd depended on this. Well, I can tell you, I don't know whether you saw it in the paper, but it shows how these things are still unfolding. President Obama made an executive decision in January this year to set aside the whole of that area, including the 1452 lands, where the industry has said there's a treasure trove of oil and gas down there. You can't set that aside as wilderness. He set aside 12 million acres as wilderness in January, just a month ago. And that means that the whole area is protected. So, I've talked long enough, and I talked to those kids this morning and gave a whole lot of interviews, and I've talked so much that I don't know whether there's a record going on in my head. But I just want to conclude, and I certainly would be happy to answer questions, but I want to conclude by saying how pleased I am to be here 40 years later. When you're 82, you are pleased to be here. And pleased to see all of you, and to know that with this kind of support for the causes that we sought to forward in the report 40 years ago. The future for the NWT looks bright. So thank you, and Masi Cho.
Since there's so many people here, we should allow opportunity for questions. I do want to, as I looked around the room during the presentation, I do want to acknowledge the people that Drew Ann Wake acknowledged in her remarks. I saw some people from Jean Marie River, and I would like to ask those people who helped with the exhibit, or if you came in from Jean Marie, if you could just stand up so we could see who you are. I know Chief Gladys Norwegian is here. Isabel Simon. At the same time, I see Decho Divisional Education Council, one person that I know, Brian Jaffray. Is anybody else here from Decho Divisional Education Council? Thank you. I think it's time for questions. I see a very eager person in the back, and I'm going to step away.
I would just like to ask if everyone who testified 40 years ago, would you stand up so we can acknowledge you, please?
Started off at UBC about 2 years ago, and it's been all over the Western Canada, and in fact farther east, and so it's fitting it should conclude its travels here in Yellowknife, where it all started. And it's Joanne worked very hard on that, and some of you had the privilege of working with her, and it's just remarkable. So I'd like to join in paying tribute to her.
For the group here. Yeah?
As you say, it is an ongoing issue. So if there is something that you could have done differently 40 years ago that we could make you apply today, what would you have done?
Well, that's kind of embarrassing question. What would I have done differently? I think on the main issues, I wouldn't have done anything differently. I mean, the Berger Inquiry gets a lot of credit for these innovations, funding the interveners, community hearings, a report that people can read, and that type of thing. But we kind of stumbled into all of that. It became apparent, given the magnitude of the task that I had been given, that we couldn't do this in the conventional way with a judge sitting in a big room in the Explorer listening to the experts, and then it goes away and writes his report and he reads it. So if we got things right, I had a lot of help from you folks and from a lot of the other people. And I should say that throughout we had the cooperation of all parties, including Arctic Gas, which was the consortium that wanted to build the gas pipeline, and Bob Blair's competing pipeline proposal, the Maple Leaf line, that was to be an all-Canadian line, and the those people from the industry came with me to the villages. They often spoke and said, well, this is why we want to build it. People listened to them. You know, they were, and they were, they collaborated throughout, they cooperated throughout. They wanted to build the pipeline, you know, so there was a clash of interest, but it wasn't as if they were unwilling to make their case as best they could. You know, you're going to hate me for this, but I really, I wish I could think of something. But when people have been telling me for 40 years that I did a terrific job, it's hard to...
In a futuristic sense, if this hadn't been done yet, would there be as much success today, starting today forward, as you had at that time, under today's conditions?
Yeah, that's the question is, if we were doing this today, would it work out as well as it did? Well, it might not. I should say, though, that at that time, in the 70s, people didn't know much about the North. They really didn't. I didn't. I'd never been to the NWT or the Yukon or Nunavut. There was no Nunavut. The NWT included the Eastern Arctic in those days. So I was learning, and I think Canadians learned along with me. They were interested in hearing what Aboriginal people had to say. They'd never heard them speak up and speak out before in a dialogue that went on for a couple of years over over this vast territory. They were interested in preservation of the northern environment. They were also interested in getting oil and gas out of the Arctic and into homes and offices and businesses in the south. So there was a lot of interest, and it was newly formed in a sense. So I think that there was a kind of a wave that we rode. People were interested, and there was such interest in Canada that we actually held hearings in the main cities of Canada, about one day in each city, and there were big turnouts just like this. Who knows what would have happened? The Prime Minister was interested at the time. And indeed, I should say, he was. No, let me, just so there's no misunderstanding. And I should tell you that he told me, he said, I appointed you because I wanted somebody independent. And that was when I was under a great deal of criticism. He's moving too slowly. When the hell is this going to finish? When can we get on with the pipeline? And he invited me to lunch, and he said, you do your best job. Now, that's a vote of confidence comes from the best possible source. But could I just add a footnote so you don't misunderstand me? The Dacho, although they haven't signed a final land claims agreement, have negotiated any number of important issues with the federal government and the territorial government. And it was Prime Minister Trudeau who set aside Nahanni National Park because he had gone canoeing there, and he said, this place should be a national park. And it was set aside by the parks people. But the Dai Cho negotiated with the federal government, and agreement was obtained to expand the Nahanni National Park sevenfold. That park is now as big as Prince Edward Island. And that's something the Dai Cho achieved in their negotiations. And Prime Minister Harper, when he officiated at the opening, said this is arguably the most important step taken to protect the northern environment. I can't remember exactly what he said, but you can find it. So we want everybody on board.
Can I ask, of all the things you saw and all the things you heard, what surprised you the most?
I don't know, really. I'm sorry. Surprised me. I was new, so coming to the villages and hearing the people and getting to know them, traveling by freighter canoe sometimes in the middle of the night through some of the tributaries of the Mackenzie to visit a fishing camp or to get to the next village, it was I don't know if it was surprising, but it was exciting. And I visited some of the summer camps of the Inuvialuit, where they what's that called, the white whales, blubber?
Muktuk.
Muktuk, yes, sampling muktuk with them at some of their summer camps. And it wasn't surprising, but it was a very worthwhile experience. I'm sorry, I'm not. I think I'm running down now. there's another question over here.
I listened to you in a lecture in Alberta on law years ago, and as an Aboriginal, I've been sitting at the table with a lot of these leaders on presidential schools, going to meetings and listening, and of course the solution is in law. I always like Rene's book, As Long as This Land Shall Last. He quoted right in the beginning, there are three sides to the stories, yours, mine, and what's actually going on. Our struggle as Indigenous people, of course you know, in the world, they fought 12 years for the United Nations to be recognized as persons. It's a funny discussion when we talk about law, because when I translate it to my elder, it says, you're a person, right? And they say, yeah. But in reality, not. Because persons in Black's book is a corporation, two-dimensional thing. So the issue we have in law and land is, this is our jurisdiction. And when we go into the courts, it's commercial. And that's the issue we're having. Because we've always had the right, before the English and anybody came, to live and barter, to trade. But as soon as we want to practice commerce, they always relegate us back to the past. We don't have a right to practice commerce. After 40 years, and I'm surprised, no leader or anybody still discuss what devolution is about and grassroots. Why do they want you to sign on to the government, the Dai Cho and the Dai Cho? For a fee simple, if you fly over Alberta, those Indigenous people gave up their right, not give up their right in 1930, they signed away their devolution, their land. They said, oh, you'll keep your treaty rights, can hunt and fish. The problem is they can't hunt and fish anymore because now everything is fenced. And you have a few spots, and maybe you can go to the park. Now they're asking the DNA. There are no boundaries and fences here. Everybody likes that because you could walk anywhere you want and no one's going to say, what are you doing here? You're free, as free as anybody in the world. Now you're asking us, and in the last 10 years or 40 years, the question hasn't been asked is, what do you want from us? Why do you want our vote so that we give you permission to license us to do all this thing and we suffer from it? No one knows that yet. But once the land is sold, you can be assured those fences are going to come just like they are around the mines. Now the caribou are moving away. And that water with bracken is being contaminated because they haven't even checked the aquifers. Did I know about COVID? 100 miles around bracken. Gas tank. Well, one thing about these indigenous people, as long as we don't sell the land, we have this authority. But our problem is residential school colonization conditioning is that we don't know who we are. And no one's telling us. There should be a four-day meeting that everybody should know. What are you voting for? Why are you selling the land, the assets, the gold, the diamonds for paper money, which is a medium of exchange that can be pulled away like that? So my question here is, I've looked in law, English common law, to resolve this, and I ask you the question in university. They said unless the land is sold, the Royal Proclamation said 1763, unless the land is sold, you can't cross into there. And why are they not respecting that? But there's still the issue of the Magna Carta. They talk about English common law, that the women still have the rights to the forest. That the king could not take that away from his mother and grandmother, that the women have a right to the forest. That hasn't been thought of. I don't know, and I followed all these courses, and I just want to, I struggle with this in my mind as an indigenous about justice. And I know you cannot go into these municipal courts, because in 69, 83 countries around the world met in the Geneva Convention, which Treaty 8 and 11, I don't know if they were part of it, because they were fraud under the Monroe case throughout. So we are still here as landowners, and we're treated like beggars, because we've got no money. But we have the authority to move that money. But our people don't know that. You send them to the English schools for 12 years in university, and still, because I went to that university and studied, I don't tell you this. So we have to look for it. So I'm looking. And I ask the question.
Well, you keep on looking. You covered a lot of subjects, but let me just tell you. When I went to law school in the 1950s, it was a good law school. University of BC. Nobody ever brought up the question of the rights of Aboriginal people. Nobody. None of the professors did. There were no courses on the rights of Aboriginal people. And none of us students ever raised it and said, what about the Indian people who live in this province, who lived here before we came? What rights do they have? None of us raised it. You know, we were learning the common law, and we learned about Magna Carta, and but we didn't hear about the Royal Proclamation of 1763. Well, I'll make this this short, but because I can only answer you by saying that when I started practicing law, by a series of accidents, I was asked to represent two Indian people on Vancouver Island who had been charged with hunting out of season. I was in the early 1960s. This goes back a long way. But we went to the Supreme Court of Canada and got a judgment that said the treaties that had been made on Vancouver Island in the 1850s were still binding on the province. Those treaties had been kept in a drawer in the provincial capital in Victoria after they were signed in the 1850s and had never been heard from again. We called an anthropologist and historian to prove that these treaties were still enforceable. The Supreme Court of Canada upheld us. Now that was, in British Columbia at least, where I come from, that was a kind of the first shot in reestablishing the rights of Aboriginal people. That led to the Nisga'a Nation coming in to see me to bring a case against the province asserting their Aboriginal title. And that had never been done before in Canada. And oddly enough, I had a little office about the size of this platform we're on with my mother, who had been widowed, working as my secretary. And the Nisga'a chiefs came in. There wasn't enough room for them to sit down, but they said, you're the young lawyer who won that case on Vancouver Island, so we want you to sue on our behalf. We went to the Supreme Court of Canada, and the Supreme Court of Canada in 1973 said Aboriginal title as part of Canadian law. Then, when the Charter of Rights was enacted, Section 35, entrenched the Aboriginal rights and treaty rights of the Aboriginal peoples of Canada. And the Supreme Court, in a series of judgments, has landmark judgments, has enlarged those rights. All I'm saying is that I can see an upward optimistic tendency. And I've always been an optimist, and at 82, you're not going to change
me. This is a great group of people, and I want to thank you again for coming out tonight, and thank Mr. Berger for his inspiring presentation, educational presentation, and we have a very small gift to offer on behalf of the museum, and it's beautifully wrapped. Government issue envelope. I'd just like to present this. One is a calendar that was produced from the archives with recipes from all over the north. The second is also from the archives, and it's a CD of a Klitschko drum song, dance songs that were recorded in 1982. And with the help of Dene Nation, I see Bill Erasmus here, and CBC North, we were able to dig those recordings out of the archives and make the CD. So you can have one of those or more if you'd like. But the most special thing is a gift that was made by one of our staff here. And she makes these beautiful covers for books. So we don't look like government when we go to meetings now. And this was made by Karen Wright Fraser, and she's got a little note inside. So thank you very much.